the physical structures will get evaporated in the times to come. And these kind of, you know, artificial intelligence methodologies will gradually take over.
Welcome to a brand new episode of Ingati CX. I'm your host, Nimalika, and we are very excited to have all of you join us today. On this show, we talk to CX and technology experts from around the world. We explore, uncover, and share fresh insights on creating experiences that your customers will remember and look forward to. Ingati is the world's leading multilingual no-code digital CX platform, available across 15 channels with 53,000 solutions created across 186 countries in every domain and use case. Ingati has also been recognized as a top platform by Inc. Magazine, Tech World, CIO Magazine, and many others. Ingati recently also won the CODI 2021 award for being the best AI-driven technology solution. We run the Ingati blog, video channel, and the Ingati CX podcast, receiving upwards of 500,000 visitors annually. Let us now welcome today's guest. Praveen Rajpal is the founder of Innovation Next Consulting. He is the innovation coach to Fortune 500 companies like Samsung, Dell, Class, JCB, Whirlpool, and many other companies. He's a Red Bull of creative thinking and developed the world's first 3D idea generator, which is helping top companies to come up with breakthrough ideas in a flash. Widely known by customers as the, Widely known by customers as the Renaissance Man, who is inspiring the next generation for moving to higher purpose, aspirations, and performance. Welcome to the show, Praveen Rajpal. Before we dive into our interview with Praveen Rajpal, don't forget to subscribe to Ingati and tap the bell icon to get access to exclusive content from thought leaders from around the globe. Welcome, Mr. Rajpal.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Nimalika. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great to have you on our show.
My pleasure.
Okay, first, I would like to ask you about your consulting company, Innovation Next. Tell us about Innovation Next.
Okay. Innovation Next is basically the market leader for digital products on the innovation and startups. I mean, we are very unconventional in the sense that, you know, while everybody was talking about innovation and startup as a consultancy organization, we were talking about innovation as a product. So, you know, we have completely productized everything in this digital world, because I believe that in this time, it is very important to come out with the digital solutions for the people and offer everything to them so that, you know, they can have the access of that at any point of time. So that is what Innovation Next in a nutshell is, basically productizing all the services which are there in the field of innovation and startups into the area of the products and digital technologies.
Could you give me one example of one of the products that Innovation Next is working on?
Okay. See, the latest product that we have is called the Worldwide Innovation Network. It's a cloud platform. On that cloud platform, what we did, we connected the innovation seekers with the innovation providers. You know, it's a global platform where, you know, the companies can actually connect with the universities, the organizations can connect with the tech startups, so governments can connect with the universities, because the whole idea is to move towards the collaborative nature of innovation. The problem is that in India, the left hand does not know what the right hand is doing. And there are so many universities in India. We have one of the largest educational ecosystems in the world, and they're not aware of what is desired by the industry. Industry needs, on the contrary, you know, some bright ideas in many fields. So what we have done is, through this Worldwide Innovation Network, which we provide to the people, to universities, to the industries, to professionals, to startups, you know, if they subscribe to that. So they can easily connect with the people, with the right kind of stakeholders for collaborative innovation, for co-innovation, actually. And that is very important. That's the latest product.
Yeah,
Yeah.
that is an extremely helpful product actually, especially when
Yes.
you said that the universities don't know what the industry needs. That is so
Yes.
true. I've come from there. You learn
Yes.
something and you come into the industry and it's a whole new world. And we have to
Yes.
start learning from scratch. We are not prepared. Yeah, that is
Absolutely.
an amazing, amazing product.
Yes.
Thank you
And
so
the
much.
most important thing is that there are so many corporate venture companies who are looking for the startups at the very, very early stage. So they don't have to pay more money when they mature. There are many of the innovation accelerators. There are many co-innovation centers who are looking for the startups at a very, very early age. What we did in this network, we have completely provided all the details of all these accelerators, the co-innovation centers, the MNC companies, the corporate venture companies, so that the students can directly get in touch with them in case they have the idea that they're looking for. I think it's
Excellent.
never in the history, never in the history of innovation, I have found that larger companies are actually supporting the students because they don't have ideas. The
True.
problem is that these 9-to-5 people are looking for the work-life balance. Innovation requires dedicated energy, passion. You know, it requires fresh ideas, which is only available with the students. And it is such an irony that these people, they need so many ideas. And the students have so many ideas. The startups have so many ideas, but they are not connected with each other. So in this platform, we have made an attempt to connect the global innovation ecosystem. The whole world is connected. So the best technology transfer offices of the universities, the best MNC accelerators, the best corporate venture companies. So when you connect the entire stakeholders together, the only thing that can happen is fast acceleration and collaboration. Because I found that one of the biggest challenges for innovation, that it is not a marathon, it's a sprint. You know, and speed is the deciding factor. You cannot be sitting in a cubicle for 2 years and innovating. So what we did, we converted the smartphone into the mobile phone incubator. That is our biggest contribution to this whole world. We have taken the smartphone to a new level. See, when you can have the bank on the smartphone, when you can have the wallet on the smartphone, right? When you can have a hospital on the smartphone, a doctor on the smartphone, right? Why cannot you have the incubator on the smartphone? So you are on the go ideas, on the go connections. Because innovation today is all about a connection, right? Suddenly you are sitting in a cab and you find that this is the company, you know, I should be getting in touch with in the future. And you are having a problem of scale up. These companies, you know, they are providing the mentors. They are providing you with the support for prototyping. They're providing you with their marketing network infrastructure. They're providing you with funding. What else do you need? And that is the problem.
It is like you've listened to the prayers of millions of students and startups and you've created this.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. You know, I would say that God has listened to my prayers because I always wanted to do something, you know, which would create a tremendous impact, not in India, but all across the globe. And today we are very happy when we get, you know, organizations, I mean, the partners from the United States to partner with us. The world's largest consulting company, which is Global Innovation Institute of USA, they have partnered with us to take our solution to 40 countries.
Congratulations.
So,
that is amazing.
So we call Vishwaguru Bharat. India has always been a giver. I believe that India has always given to the world. And it is also such a great satisfaction to me as a professional that, you know, the East, which was looking at the West, suddenly we find that the West is looking towards the East, and that too in an area which was called a jugaad in India. So innovation was never, I mean, we always felt that, you know, India has never done anything as far as innovation is concerned. But I think this solution of ours is now connecting the whole world, and suddenly we have the globe as our customers. I
great.
Feel great.
This is
and
like
I
a
always...
goosebumps moment for me right now. I'm not lying.
Yes, yes,
it's
and very
amazing.
soon, very soon, our new website, which is being developed in US, should be out by the first week of October. I would be very happy to share that website with you, and you can share it with larger community that you have, so that Definitely. Millions and millions of students forget about innovation. They do not even have the access to world-class mentors, the world-class Yes. knowledge. So this is the complete knowledge management system we provide to them on the go, which means the mobile phone is your innovation powerhouse. It is an Yes. engine of innovation. Millions of students all over the world do not have the access to the universities today, the physical incubators today. It's very expensive. They cannot learn over there. Money has been a big issue. In a very paltry amount of money, as a lifetime license, meager lifetime license, we allow the student to get so much of knowledge and so much of, you know, facilities on this platform.
Yeah.
Well, that is, I think, my big satisfaction.
Excellent. So what is the industry 4.0? Will 5G play a major role in industry 4.0?
The industry 4.0 is nothing but using the pivotal technologies and the assistive technologies in the right way. Like what we did, we knew that mobile phone is going to be an enabler. We knew that the cloud is going to be the enabler. We knew that EdTech will be the future. We also knew that artificial intelligence will be the future. What we have done is actually industry 5.0 and not just 4.0. How do you use the assistive technologies? How do you use the upcoming trends? So we don't allow, I mean, I believe that why should there be anybody in between the artificial intelligence and the student? The student says, give it to me the way I want, whenever I want, at the time I want, in a manner that I want, right? That typical conventional classroom has been disrupted. You don't need that. So, I mean, we are selling certificates. We are selling degrees. There is so much of similar that it has lost its shine. The only differentiator is an idea. The only differentiator that you have today is an idea. And that is why Tesla says, I don't care about the qualifications. Right? He says, give me the people, give me the students who are passionate about pursuing their ideas. And, you know, they find a job in Tesla. I think that's what the world is. And, you know, we are following conventional methods. And those innovation next is a trailblazer in breaking all the rules. So we defy
conventions. What you said is true. Yeah.
We defy the conventions. I don't say that you don't need formal qualification. At the same time, I say with that, you must have an idea. You must have, a passion that you want to pursue. You must know what is it that you want to bring to the world. I think that's very important.
Yeah, completely agree.
Yeah.
So how does the smartphone incubator actually work? How will this help in the edtech sector?
Yeah, it's very simple. You know, we have a B2B model where the universities would subscribe to that. And the moment they subscribe to that, they would get the license to operate on the smartphone and the device. So each student will get a license to work on a device, which could be a tab or a computer, a laptop or whatever it is, and one smartphone. So the moment the university subscribes to this, all the students in the universities will get this kind of a package. It's very simple. It's like subscribing to a cloud platform. And we provide to them the username and password to access that. Very simple. Yeah.
Okay. How can organizations leverage disruptive technology and apply human-centric design to create products Yes. that help make the customer experience vision, come to light?
Yes. You see, the organizations these days, they will have to be very agile. And they have to understand one thing, that they will have to, before the competition breaks their products, they have to break their own product, and they have to integrate the technologies with their products, because every product actually can become a smart product. So how do you make the smart products? How you convert, the table that you're sitting in can become a smart table. the chair that you're sitting in can become a smart chair. So I think most of the products that we were talking about, this whole digital transformation which is happening in the world, can enable the organizations to move to the next level. I think they have to use, first of all, the artificial intelligence, because this age is the rise and rise of AI. If they do not do that, if they do not use those digital technologies and what I call pivotal and assistive and the assistive technologies, it will be very difficult for them to survive. And even a small startup tech, a small tech startup can disrupt a large organization. So I think the organizations will have to move fast. They have to collaborate fast. They have to adopt digital transformations, integrate maximum technologies into their products and services and business models. The idea of creating a new product experience, the idea of creating a new experience in the product cannot happen unless you adopt digital technologies. So the whole world has changed. And I think this is what is very, very important for the companies. More important than that, I believe organizations from the closed innovation must transform to open innovation. Many companies in India, they still follow the closed innovation policies. As I said, the left hand does not know what the right is doing, whereas the MNCs have shifted to the open innovation. So the thought process in a company is that everything will have to be done inside the organization. But the thought process in an open innovation company is that everything will be integrated from external sources into the organization. You don't get a Nobel Prize for doing everything on your own, right? So why unnecessarily delay the entire process? Because the wheel is being reinvented. My problem is that everything has been done. The wheel is being reinvented. Please get in touch with the technology solution providers, which are there worldwide. They have done it for you. They have done it because they're looking for the market. The problem is the countries who are very, very great in technologies are mere dots in this world. They are very, very small, whether it is Finland or Denmark or Switzerland or Germany, they are tiny dots. I mean, much, much so smaller than a village of India, right?
Correct.
Markets, they exist in India. So I think we should do, instead of trying to develop technologies, we should try to create the applications of those technologies in India. And that is how, the world becomes an interdependent, collaborative world that, we are talking about. So that is very important. Otherwise, we are going to, again, have a marathon and not a sprint.
Yes. So this smartphone incubator, right? You said the universities will get a license and they get to use it with all the students. So this university setup is different from the edtech culture that is going on, which is online courses, etc., etc. So how is this smartphone incubator going to influence this edtech sector?
See, smartphone incubator is nothing but an edtech only. It is actually the education technology. Right. The incubator is basically not requiring a student to go to a physical incubator because today he cannot travel. So many of the students who cannot come to universities, there are no professors today, right? Because of the pandemic, which has really, been lasting for the last about 2 years or so. Even if the pandemic goes, the digital mindset is here to stay. The students will still want the things, right on their smartphones. So this smartphone is an extension of an education technology. Many of the students, let me give you one very big example. The Indian government says that every university in India must democratize innovations, which means innovation and entrepreneurship will not be confined to ESEL, but the entire institute should learn about it, because that is very important from the jobs perspective in the future.
Okay.
But where are the professors? If a university has 10,000 students, and if they have to follow the policy of Government of India to democratize this, to train 10,000 students, you will at least need about 100 to 200 new professors. Can you imagine the cost? So this incubator actually saves millions and billions of rupees for those kind of institutions today who cannot afford to have such a large strength of the professors with them. So we try to bring in tremendous amount of value propositions and ensure that the requirement of the government is completely followed. And tomorrow, if these institutions have to get themselves ranked, you know, on ARIA, which is utter ranking of the, you know, innovation institutes achievements, which they have to do, they don't score poorly over it. Otherwise, it's going to be a big problem for them. The problem is that the conformity policies of the government of India today are really a major, major issue. They cannot comply. Niti Aayog wants even the states to improve upon the state innovation indexes. How will they do that? You know, because the state innovation index depends on the universities. It depends on the quality of the knowledge workers which they have created, because those knowledge workers are going to create the quantity and the quality of the startups. And that is what, which is deciding the innovation ranking of a state. The innovation ranking of the state decides the global innovation index of our India. Right? We moved on two spots, but I believe that to catch up with the world, you know, India should be at least sitting pretty in the first 10, 15 positions. That cannot happen unless every student adopts this incubator. And instead of just having a qualification, he comes out with an idea, you know, for which is going to create a solution, an innovative solution for the whole world, for the industry, for the company, for the business, for the society, you know. And that is how our patent per million is going to rise. Unfortunately, our patent per million is only 35 compared to 3,400 of Korea.
Oh.
So where do we stand? And that is how Korea became one of the most innovative countries, because they practice open innovation and collaboration between the universities and the organizations. Japan follows that. Germany follows that. USA follows that. What stops India? I think what stopped India was the sheer size of the country, and they did not know how to connect with each other. So the kind of job that we have done will not just end up one problem. I think it is going to resolve multiple issues, multiple challenges. And sometimes you say, you know, you just need one solution to resolve all the challenges. And I believe this is the solution which gives a higher rank to the student, to a university, to a state, to the country, and to the overall global competitiveness index. I believe that is very important, and ultimately affecting the GDP of the country, because the per capita GDP of India, again, let me tell you, is not very healthy. We are sitting, I think, on the 140th or 145th rank in the world. I'm talking about per capita, which means that the value creation part by a student is very less.
Yeah.
On the contrary, Stanford, handful of people, you know, Google, PayPal, Tesla Motors, their annual contribution to the world is $2 trillion. And India's GDP is $1.7 trillion. One institute beats. So my vision is to actually, you know, make sure that, you know, every institution of India becomes a Stanford. We have that. We have the metal. Our students have the intellect. They are the most intelligent people in the world. They lack the direction. You know, given the right direction, given the right setup, given the right knowledge, and given the right set of skills and mindsets, I believe that every student has the power to become a Sundar Pichai. You know, every student.
That is
there in the
blood. It is just the lack of exposure, either exposure or lack of having the idea, because there are so many ideas around. One person might have an idea and he'll have this confusion whether his idea will go forward. Will I be?
Nibilika, very true. And Nibilika, the most important thing is the students don't know how to convert their ideas into a business model.
The problem is
that in India, we have 90% education institutions as an engineering institutions. However, to commercialize an idea, you need a commercial mind. So when they go on the World Innovation Network platform, they find all the tools that enables these engineering students to transform their engineering ideas into the commercial models.
Yeah.
You get my point? This is because of the fragmented method of study that we had, you know, right from
exactly.
the very beginning.
Yeah.
And that is
so
where
the whole
education
we get is not holistic. It's just one directional. We don't know what is happening in the business sector. What do I do with the money? What do I do with the market? True.
Right.
Yes.
Right. That is why the new education policy emphasizes the need for the multidisciplinary learning.
Yes.
So you should not only know the aeronautical engineering, you must also know electronics. Because it is the diversity and the bandwidth of the technological ideas which will enable you to connect the dots. And unless you have that, you will never be able to connect those dots. And if innovation is all about connecting the dots, that is very much required.
Yeah.
So this platform that we provide to the people has got 4,200 resources connecting the entire world of innovation. Directly, indirectly, I don't know how many. But this is going to be a very, very important resource for the students and the next generation to have it, use it, explore, and become the power that actually you can. So we want to unleash that power.
It will be a revolution and a blessing both together.
I think this is a breakthrough news for the world. And through your channel, through this interview, if all the universities and if all the corporates, you know, if they get to know this kind of a news that Innovation Next, our World Innovation Network, that's the company that we have, has come out with the solution, I think it is going to create a great value addition to whatever they are doing in life.
Yeah. And how do you see the technology evolving over the next 10 years? And following that, how effective is a chatbot or a live chat platform or a tool helping the edtech culture?
Yeah. You see, one thing we have to know that the sheer pace of the, you know, the change of the technologies, that in itself is a challenge for the people today. Technologies are evolving at a very fast pace. The artificial intelligence is expanding at a very fast pace. So we have to be faster than that transformation. As long as the organizations are faster than the change of the technologies, you know, they will be winning the race, or else, you know, they are going to be defeated. So technologies would be the very, very important part. Chatbots or any kind of, digital solutions which are coming right now are gradually taking over. I think in the next about 1 or 2 years, they would become even more prominent. The robots have taken the place in the restaurants. So they have become the chefs. The technology, the rockets are actually 3D printed today. So you don't need a factory to print a rocket. The homes are getting manufactured, right? So you don't need typical conventional methods of, you know, creating the homes. The robots have taken over the farms. So the strawberries are being picked up by the robots in France, and so on and so forth. I think the world has evolved. It has really, really evolved to a next level. The vertical farms are already there. You know, the 3D printed human organs are already there. The implantable chips are coming in. The medicines of the future are going to be the medicines which are not going to be pills, right? So it is a very, very different world, right from the healthcare to any kind of an engineering, to any kind of a sector. Technologies would evolve at a very fast pace. And if we are not able to keep the pace with them, I think we are going to be left behind. So it is a very big responsibility for technologies, for the organizations and for the universities to ensure that, you know, they are ahead of the technology curve. You know, otherwise, one fine morning, they will wake up and see how Nokia became out of business. You know, so Samsung went to Silicon Valley, partnered with Google, and the world leader having 75% market share in India was thrown out. So this is what I say, the innovation is today is all about collaboration. Samsung had no innovation capacity compared to Nokia. but Samsung went to Silicon Valley. So this World Innovation Network is nothing but a Silicon Valley in your hands. You don't have to travel to America because all the technology providers are there on your smartphone. Whom do you want to collaborate? So that is the reason we have provided this kind of a tool to people so that they're aware of the kind of new technologies which are coming in. They can get updated information about the new applications of technologies. A drone for defense, for example, which is so much needed these days. How it can resolve your challenges, how the drones can resolve the challenges of a mining industry. We have seen so much of fire during the last year, in Greece, in Turkey, in Australia. The company came up with an idea of creating a drone for reforestation. So wherever the fire was there, this drone would fly and spread the seeds because it was not possible to do in those hilly areas by the humans. Look at the problem and look at the solution. It's a great idea. It's a great idea of how your problems are going to be addressed by the technologies. One final thing I want to say here about technologies, AI and human intelligence. AI can never take the place of human intelligence. Human intelligence will know how to use that AI. So I think as long as we are the imagineers, that I say, as long as we are the thinkers, as long as we have that creative power in us, AI can never overtake us. So technology and the human intelligence will have to go together. But we have to make sure that we are faster than the AI.
Yeah, it should be human-centered AI, but not AI-centered humans.
Yes.
Something
yes.
like that. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It
so
should be.
If we just.
No, please carry on. You said it. Yeah.
So if we look just at the edtech domain, how will chatbots or live chat be effective in the edtech sector?
The effectiveness of the chatbox and this depends on the alpha generation. How are the kids going to respond to it? I think that is very important. The children, it is said the child is the father of man. So we have to know the responses of the alpha generation, who are just about 10 to 12 years right now. How are they responding? How do they feel when the chat box talks to them? I think this is more of an area of a research, I would say, at this present moment, because many people are not comfortable. I see a chat box and I close it. Because I know that it cannot give me the answers that I have. Because I know the limitations of chatbots, right?
Yes.
So we have to find out. Yeah, because I have very typical questions, which the chatbots will say that, it would give me standard answers. But I'm looking for some solution at that point of time. Yes, for standardized answers, for typical, answers which are absolutely, common to all the people, they can be always used, right? I mean, where do I get this? Where do I go? Where do I make the payment? How do I go? Can you show me a video? I mean, all that. Even the Indian income, the GST portal, the bank portals, all of them, they have started adopting the chat box and there are no humans today. The physical structures of the bank has completely been taken over by the digital structures, right? So the physical structures will get evaporated in the times to come. And these kind of, artificial intelligence methodologies will gradually take over. So when all these bigger institutions have already started experimenting with them, it definitely means that they are very potent. And if not 10%, if not 20%, at least 70% of the problems they're able to resolve now. As we go along the period of time, the time will come when people like Sophia, would be there on your chat box and say that I can intelligently answer your questions as well. So I think innovation is more of a revolutionary journey. I mean, Google started from, a dormitory as a search engine. And today it is being used as a research engine for people, right? And they're talking about the driverless cars today. Well, that's the world. I mean, the innovation really evolved. Tim Berners-Lee never thought that the face of internet would be this. Because he had a problem of downloading softwares, when he was working in CERN, and just imagine, why cannot there be a common software? And he said this, there should be a language called HTML. But that HTML has completely changed the way you and me are interviewing today.
Yeah.
It's changed the way we work, we live, we play, we have fun, you know, we do entertainment. I mean, we do everything in life. So to predict what shape will a particular technology take place in the times to come is difficult. But to say that it's going to evolve is definitely, with it goes without any saying. IBM said that there's a need for 5 computers in the world. Look at what has happened to the computers. Every child carries a computer. Bill Gates said 640 KB should be enough. But the computers are into GBs. The RAM is into GBs today. The best of the experts cannot predict the future.
Yeah.
It evolves.
Okay.
It comes to you. It comes to you.
Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful talking to you. Okay. Do you have any more sound bites you would like to leave our audience with?
Well, I only want to wish everybody, a very great success in their lives. And I just have a message. Be the man of ideas. Try to resolve a global challenge. Try to resolve a country's challenge. Try to resolve a city's challenge. If not that, your village's challenge. If not that, anybody's challenge. You never know that solution that you have created one day will become so big that the whole world is going to be helped with that. You know, that is the only message I have. And I have one story. This man had 2 trucks. The book from, you know, Mark Levinson, the title of the book is The Box. It says how the box completely transformed the whole world's business. It made the business of the world so big and the world so small. The story says that he had 2 trucks. He could send the trucks on the ship. He had a fleet of 4 trucks. He had to have 2 rounds of the trucks. The business became bigger and he had 8 trucks. And he was having no solution because the ships were not making so many rounds. So he was wondering what to do. He thought of an idea. The idea was to remove, to put the truck on a truck. That did not work. So then he thought that the idea could be to remove the wheels. And when the wheels were removed, the shipping container was born. So this man who was trying to resolve his problem completely changed the face of the world. This small, humble shipping container, which is no rocket science, redefined the entire shipping industry. It touched every port in the world. It transformed the business of the world. It made the business of the world so big and the world so small. That's the only message I have. When you are trying to resolve your own challenge, you actually land up creating something which is a breakthrough for them.
A solution for the whole world.
Yeah, that's the message I have. So don't think that this problem is small. You may land up actually creating a global solution.
True.
Pursue that idea.
Yeah. Your message has personally touched me, and I wanted to reach out to every corner in the world, because this is what people who are studying right now need.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank and you I'm so, always available. So I'm always wonderful talking to you, Nimalika. And, you know, I'm always available. At any point of time, if you think that you need a second interview of mine, you need an extension of this, do let me know. I'll be more than happy. If any university, any college, any company, anyone wants a Zoom with me personally or a one-to-one basis, if any of your students want to talk to me, I'm always available, because I believe that every association that you have, it can turn to be very big in life. So I would definitely be very happy to talk to you and to your team or to anybody else, even working out a mutually collaborative association, how we can take this up, you know, and offer a solution to everyone.
Thank you so much, Praveen Rajpalji, for giving us your time. Your insights were very, very valuable. And I know our audience is really going to enjoy this show.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to have the feedback from people as to how they felt about it.
We'll be back with a new episode with a brand new expert soon. So stay tuned and we'll see you around for the next one. Bye-bye.